accidents and accusations, messages and misperceptions paralyze my mind. Buses, cars, and airplanes leaving, burning fumes of gasoline. Everyone is running, and I come to find the refuge in the easy silence that you make for me. It's okay when there's nothing more to say to me. Plays on every station, answers only make more questions. I need something to believe in, breathing sanctuary in the easy silence that you make for me. It's okay when there's nothing more to say to me. In the peaceful quiet you create for me, and the way
good morning. Good morning. My name is Mark O'Keefe, and I am one of the worship leaders here at NAC. And if this is your first time here, then I welcome you with open arms. New England Chapel was built for people who may have given up on church, but not on God. So it's funny. Spring, I think, if I'm right, is starting like in a week or so. And spring to me is the promise of nicer weather, and the flowers start to bloom, and most importantly, baseball season starts. But I look outside, and like yesterday, that rain and the snow and the cold, it was just frigid. It was just a raw day. And then we had to set our clocks, ahead last night, right? Which I think it's daylight savings began, which is kind of weird because we lose an hour. You think if we're saving, we're going to, I don't know, it doesn't make sense to me, but I'm really proud of everyone for being here this morning, because it was rough after the weather yesterday, getting up, probably tired, so you guys are the good ones. You're the good souls who actually did it and made it here, so congratulations. We are in the middle of a series called I Changed My Mind and It Changed Everything. Now, little aside, my wife is not here in this service today, but when she comes in, she's going to see that I moved the keyboard back here today. I move furniture at home all the time. Like I don't know what's wrong with me. I just have to move furniture, and she goes crazy. It's like, I don't know why you're doing this, but we're talking about change today. So for me, it's change, and maybe that's a thing I need in my life. I don't know what it is, but here's how it goes. I changed my mind, and it changed everything. That's the topic today. A change Any change for the better starts with a thought. It starts in the mind. It works in our words and our actions, and eventually our character. So the question is, are we open to change? So Mike is going to delve far more deeply into this theme this morning. His focus is going to be on courage and fear. So as always, if you are inclined to sing along with us, please feel free to sing along with us. And if you're not, just sit back and enjoy the music. We like that as well. So I invite you now to stand. And if you will, join us in our next song, which is Hear Our Praises. Have a seat, please.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Gosh, it feels good to be back. I was gone for 2 weeks. I don't know if you noticed. You did? Good, thank you. I was thinking to myself, it's really good to be home, right? And then I was thinking about the announcements I get to make here. If you don't know me, my name is Heather. I'm one of the pastors here, and one of my best parts of my job is I get to invite you in. And today I have three kind of invitations for you, and all of them are, bear with me, they're about being home, okay? So the first one is, every month we host these two things. One of them is Get to Know New England Chapel. So perhaps you consider this your home, perhaps you're still not sure because you want to see what we're hiding behind stage, and you want to learn a little bit more about who we are and why we're here and how we got started. That is a session that I invite you to come to today. It's after second service, so you'd have to go get breakfast and come back. But if you meet me in the front of the sanctuary, I can tell you a bit about NEC. And then also, the second Sunday of every month, we start a new journey class. We know you've all mostly heard about it, but this time around, Laura Leard is going to be leading that. The journey class is for anyone who wants to dive a little bit deeper into faith, and that means, when I say anyone, I mean everyone. Doesn't matter if you've been coming to church for, you know, 10 years or this is your first month here. It's an opportunity to go a little bit deeper into understanding who God is, what the Bible's all about. And so that starts today after this service in the conference room. So that's about our home. May I step into your home for a moment? When I talk to you about a little event we're having next Saturday, 9 to 11. This is for couples, and we are inviting someone who's going to come in. She's a marriage coach. She's going to talk about having the best marriage you can. Someone said something to me interesting this week. Well, Heather, if I sign up for that, they'll know my marriage is in trouble. No. What I will know is that, like all of us, we want our marriages to be good, and we know that it takes continued effort. So we hope that you can join us for that. It's going to be a great morning. Breakfast will be served too. And any proceeds, $20 to join us, and that's all going to go towards the refugee walk happening the same time. So let's step out of your home into the global home. And I want to let you know that we have an awesome prayer team here. In fact, right outside these doors is a prayer area where you can write a prayer for someone to pray for you. You can pray with somebody. But next week, after second service, the prayer team is inviting anyone who would like to join them for prayer. And they're going to be praying for current events. And, well, God knows we have a lot of those to pray for. So if you can join them, it's going to be in Little Kid Zone after service. So those are my three invitations. But right now, I'd like to make another invitation and invite the Ward family up. Today, their son is going to get baptized, and Mike's going to come out and lead them in that.
Thanks, Heather. So if this is your first time at New England Chapel, come on over, gang. If this is your first time at New England Chapel, we do a couple different types of baptisms here. We baptize infants into the promises of God, into the family of God, with the hopes that someday they, whether it's 8 years old or 18 years old or 80 years old, they turn around and profess the faith that they've been baptized into. We actually are having one of those in the second service. Today we're doing an immersion baptism, which whenever someone is able to articulate their own faith and show proof that they have embraced that faith, then we skip the baptized into the promises of God, and we just go right to the profession of faith, embracing those promises, and that's what we're doing today. And so I had an opportunity about a few weeks ago, maybe a month ago, to interview Mason and say, hey, why do you want to be baptized? And he gave an eight-year-old response that mirrored what you get taught in the journey. So I was like, you are ready, kid. In fact, you want to teach our next journey class, you know? No. So Mason, I'm going to ask you to answer those two questions that I asked you in front of all of us, just as a way for them to understand the reason why you want to get baptized. And I'm pulling this off because I forgot to get you a microphone. So, Mason, how did I word that? Hold on a second. I have it written down here. I don't want to throw you a curveball. Oh yeah. First question I asked was, what do you think about God?
That God wants to watch over us and he loves us.
Yes, yep. And the second one was, what does God think about you?
He thinks that we're all equal and he loves us no matter what.
Awesome. And so as we talked more that time, I saw that there is no reason not to baptize Mason. He understands what Christ did and what that means. And baptism and the full immersion, especially the full immersion part of the sacrament, is sort of a public declaration that We're being buried going into the water from the old way of living life. And the old way of living life is life on autopilot, just doing whatever your selfishness or fear or ego tells you to do, just living on an autopilot. And so you're going down saying, hey, I'm not doing life on my own anymore. I'm coming up. I'm raising up into this new way of life where I recognize that God is with me, God loves me, I'm not on my own, and I will follow God. And so that's what's going to happen over here. So, and the cool thing about it is Scott agreed to get in the tub with Mason, right? Right? This is cool, actually, because Kellen represents our infant baptism, and Mason represents our adult baptisms. And so in the family, you get the whole spectrum of New England Chapel Reformed theology on baptism. Yeah, so jump on in there. And I'm going to ask you to face this way, okay? And then, yep. Perfect, perfect. Wow, you are a good listener. And see, it's actually kind of warm, huh?
Yeah.
We tapped into the hot water heater. All right. Mason Ward, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Come on out. Oops. Yeah, take that one too. Let's pray for you guys before you leave, okay? Heavenly Father, we celebrate with the Ward family of this declaration that Mason undertook and this public sign that he knows that he's yours. And so as we celebrate with them, I pray that it's also a reminder to us that we are not alone, that the creator of the universe loves and cares for us, and that when we open up, you come in and walk alongside of us. We pray good things for not only Mason, but Kellen and the Ward family as they embark or continue on this journey of following you. Pray this all in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you. And Mason, we have a Bible for you. And Kate, yep.
Thank you.
Yep.
Turn to when I act
Thank you. I realized I forgot to introduce myself. This is your first time. My name is Mike. I'm one of the three pastors, and well, we're glad you're here. And you get to see a sacrament, and you know, you get the full thing. This is the sermon part of the service if you're new. And what a sermon is basically we take some good stuff from the Bible and we show how relevant it is and helpful it is for everyday life, and how it opens us up to God and discovering Him and allowing us to let Him bring out the best in us in everyday life. And we work in series usually. Series is just a way for us to string a big idea over a series of weeks. And the series that we're in, as Mark introduced, is called I Changed My Mind and It Changed Everything. This is going to be, it's actually weird. Preaching with a damp sleeve. I should have wore a polo shirt next time. I changed my mind, and it changed everything. I think one of the ways that I can help you understand this is by thinking about some of the top grossing movies of our time. And so the number one top grossing movie of all time is Avatar. How many people saw Avatar? All right. Most of us. The next, number two was Avengers Endgame. Who saw Avengers Endgame? Oh, actually, it might be less than Avatar. That's wrong. That was a great movie. Titanic, how about that? Yeah, whoa, wow. You know what? I remember when this came out, there was a woman from Revere. If you're here, I'm sorry for be pointing you out, who saw it 17 times. Can you imagine that the movie gripped her so much that she saw it 17 times? And then the last one, this is actually number six, but this is still in the movie theaters. And so this is the last highest grossing, top 10 highest grossing movie, and Spider-Man No Way Home. Who's seen that? All right, I won't spoil it but what makes us spend, so Avatar is nearly $3 billion worth of box office sales. Can you imagine that? $1 billion, multiple billions of dollars are represented in those four. Almost all of them are 2 mil, except for Spider-Man, he's like 1.5 mil. Billion. And so it's just amazing. And if you think about those movies, they all have very similar elements. And I'm not going to spoil Spider-Man No Way Home, but all of them have this sense of good triumphing over evil, courage in the face of death, or in the face of persecution, or in the face of something. You know, in Avatar, it's someone disobeying, a paraplegic Marine has an avatar, and he decides to disobey orders for the sake of saving a planet and protecting life. We resonate with that, and that makes us want to go see it, and makes us want to share it. Hey, that's a great movie. You should really go see Avatar. And then Endgame. Endgame is all about I'm going to spoil that one because you should have seen it by now. It's like 4 years old. Yeah. I won't say who, but one of the main characters literally lays his life down for the sake of his friends, for the sake of the world. Courage, love, compassion, sacrifice. You know, Titanic, obviously, Jack? I can't remember. It's been so long. And Rose, was it Jack and Rose? And he literally gives up his spot on the raft for his love interest. And it's a story about class struggle and self-sacrifice. And it just resonates to the point where someone from a Revere would see it 17 times in a row. I won't spoil Spider-Man Far From Home, but it's the same stuff. It's the self-sacrifice, this courage, that when we see it live, there's something in our soul that resonates with that. And I would say there's a theological reason why we resonate with those kind of virtues, courage, self-sacrifice, honor, rising above your circumstances, perseverance, getting up again and again to do the right thing. We resonate with that because we are made in God's image and God's likeness. That's the foundation for our connection with God. God said, you are created to mirror me in the world around you. When you're brave, when you're honest, when you're courageous, when you're creative, when you bring a little bit of humor to bring levity and conversation, continue the conversation. All those things, when you're truthful, when you're compassionate, when you're generous, when you push back your fear and you do what's right, all those things are, you're imaging God. And that's our purpose, is to reflect God's goodness, reflect God's characteristics in the world around us. And so that's what that last series was about, and that's what this series is about. But in this series, we're actually looking at not really our actions, but our thinking. I changed my mind, and it changed everything. And we're specifically looking at, so we don't have to guess, well, what is being made in the image of God? How does that affect my thinking? What we're just going to do is we've been looking at a verse in Philippians that says, have the mind of Christ. If you want to lean into your image of godness, have the mind of Jesus. And we've been looking at elements of Jesus's mindset. Last week was the strength of humility and how humility is powerful both for the person given it, but even more so for the person on the receiving end of humility. And humility can be a very, very strong force. Today we're looking at courage, and I want to start, courage is a huge mindset of Christ, and you could see that not only through how he faced the crucifixion, his death and resurrection, but every twist and turn in Jesus' life, you could see that he had a mindset of courage, and we're going to look at an episode about that. But before we do, I want to read for you a paragraph from an amazing speech that one of our former presidents, Teddy Roosevelt, so this is going way back. None of us were around, I don't think, when Teddy was around, unless you are over 100 years old. This is a speech that he was giving in one of the oldest universities on the planet, in Paris. And he is surrounded by dignitaries and academics and politicians and government leaders. And here this sort of American upstart, Teddy Roosevelt, is coming and he's addressing them. And it's an amazing speech. But there's a paragraph in that speech where it's been quoted by a million people. It's been quoted by JFK. It's been quoted by, a bunch of different TED Talks. And it's actually stolen by yours truly, Tom Brady. It's the name Man in the Arena. There's a paragraph in that speech that talks about the man in the arena. And it the speech has been called the Man in the Arena speech, but it's not its official title. Its official title is Citizenship in a Republic. And so basically what he's talking about is how societies thrive, and it's all up to us individually to embody a certain characteristic. So I just want to read a small paragraph from that. I have that up there. I was trying to find an original recording, but I couldn't. I found JFK's reading it, which was pretty cool, but I'm just going to read it for you. It's not going to be as good. But so it's not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles, or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. Hold on to that slide for a second. So already I start to feel a little disheartened about the times I live in. Roosevelt's saying, it's not the critic who counts, not the one who points out how someone else stumbles or how someone could have done a better job in their attempts. I feel like the critic is such a huge voice. If you were to take out the armchair critic who doesn't actually jump into the arena, who doesn't actually try, but just pokes holes in other people's attempts, if you were to take all that out of social media and news reporting, I think we would have half the content gone. There are people who literally make a living off getting paid to poke holes in other people's legitimate, authentic attempts. So Teddy is saying, it's not the, if I can call him Teddy, it's not the critic who counts. It's not the man who or woman who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the one who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs, all right, makes mistakes, who comes short again and again. That's the one who the credit belongs to. Because there is no effort without error and shortcoming. But who does actually strive to do the deeds? Who knows the great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the best knows, in the end, the triumph of achievement, high achievement, or who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither know victory nor defeat. Isn't that amazing? 1910. He's saying, don't worry about the critic who doesn't try. They won't know defeat, but they won't know victory. And even if you don't know victory, the credit goes to you who are in there trying. It actually makes me a little sad because I feel like we've gone away from that as a culture. You know, we're so worried about ourselves and can you believe that what they said and this and that and the other thing. And we're so self-defensive and self-protective and individualistic that this kind of courage is seemingly evaporated. Now, I'm not sure if this sentence that I'm about to say is true or not, but it feels to me like where we no longer step up in everyday courage, we need to enact more laws, and we need more government programs, and we need more NGOs to pop up, because humanity, human beings, individuals, are no longer stepping up in that kind of courage, taking those kind of risks, making themselves vulnerable. That could be wrong, but I do know one thing. I do know that I, care so much about what other people think that it often can paralyze us to step up into everyday moments of courage. I'll give you a great example. One of my biggest regrets in ministry happened about 20 years ago when I was a baby pastor, brand new, and I was driving through town, and this is when I lived up on the North Shore in Danvers. I was driving in town, and I saw a bunch of people over on the left just kind of mulling around, and then I came to the light across from them, and it dawned on me that that's the same location where two nights before there was a fatal car crash where two teens were drag racing and one swerved off and hit the telephone pole. And so these folks were just kind of mulling around like, just sad and, you know, kind of slumped down. And I kind of felt a nudge to pull over and go over there and offer to pray with them, or offer a listening ear, or offer a perspective. And as soon as I had that nudge, this is all in the instant because I'm sitting at a red light, a bunch of other thoughts flooded my mind. What if someone else is going to do that? What if they don't want that? What if that's awkward? What if it makes it worse? And all those things flooded my mind, basically wondering how I'll come off. The light turned green, and I hit the gas and drove off and missed the opportunity. It was an early regret that I think just epitomizes how easy it is to feel awkward or feel the pressure of appearances and cause you to miss a step in courage, or cause me to miss a step in courage. And so I want to talk about courage and having the mindset of courage that Christ displays. And I don't want to talk about courage in the sense that we often talk about courage. We often talk about courage in heroic acts, like at war, or someone's drowning in a lake and someone jumped in and saved them. Those are like extraordinary events. You know, I've been reading just individual people's courageous acts in the war in the Ukraine, the invasion of Ukraine. Every day there seems to be a new one, a grandmother or a child or a soldier or a mayor or something. I'm not talking about those acts. Those are extraordinary. Those don't happen every single day. Those don't happen in your living room or in your workplace, right? I'm talking about everyday little acts. And so let's take a look at what Jesus experienced and how he responded. And it'll shed a lot of light on what courage in the little things. Now, I want to give you a little bit of heads up that when we read this, you're going to be like, whoa. they were really harsh in the Old Testament. And if you want to figure out why aren't we so harsh anymore, what's going on with that, was that God really liked that, take the journey. They actually cover it in the first class. In the very first class of Journey Experience 101. And so this is a story where people are trying to, religious mucky-mucks, religious leaders are trying to trap and trick Jesus because they don't like his message. they don't like his message of love and forgiveness for everyone. And so they're trying to trap him, and they know he's a sucker for the underdog. They know he's a sucker for sinners. And so we're going to hit a passage where, let's just read it. At dawn, and you know that dawn came at like 6:30 today. What's up with that? I'm used to driving to the church. I come here pretty early in the morning. I'm used to driving in light, and it was completely dark today. But so at dawn, so this is very early in the morning, Jesus appeared again at the temple courts. And this was not inside a building. The temple court was like almost like you're inside the wall of the first wall of a castle. Right, so it would be a wall, and there'd be a lot of open space, and then there would be the temple. And so it's not like he's inside a building, because it won't make sense. But so he's inside the temple courts, outside, but inside the wall, and the people are gathered around him, and he sat down to teach, which I think is crazy that they actually sat down when they were teaching. I couldn't teach sitting down. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman caught in adultery. Now, you immediately know something's up because one person can't have adultery. It always takes two people, and there's only one person there, right? And they made her stand before the group and said to Jesus, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law of Moses, Moses commands us to stone such a woman, capital punishment." Actually, a lot of things counted for capital punishment. So, adultery is the seventh commandment. You back up two commandments earlier. In the fifth commandment, you say, honor your mother and father. That was capital punishment if you cursed your mother and father, if you dishonored them, all right? We wouldn't have any kids today, right? So go to the journey and figure out why we don't do that anymore. They're trying to trap Jesus. Let's look at the next slide. Now, what do you say? They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis for accusing him. So now Jesus is on the spot, and they're trying to trap him because they know his heart, and they know his leanings, and he has a track record of always bailing out the sinner. And so they're like, oh, we'll get him. They probably, this is a guess, there's no proof of this, but the fact that they only had one person, they probably paid some dude to set her up in order to bring her before Jesus. It's definitely a concocted plan in order to trap Jesus. Because if Jesus, well, here's the deal. If Jesus says, you guys are off your rocker, then they arrest Jesus for not caring about God, for blaspheming, saying he's from God, but he's not from God, because he's putting down the law, and they're going to arrest him and probably do a lot more worse than arresting, right? So this is a risky moment for him. But if he says, oh, yeah, you're right, the law is the law, guess what happens? That girl gets it. So it's a pretty tricky spot that they really cornered Jesus in. But Jesus bends down, takes the attention off of at least the woman, and he starts to write on the ground with his finger. Now, nobody knows exactly what they mean by this, but a lot of Bible scholars think that he was writing the Ten Commandments in the dirt, because writing with his finger, that same phrase is used in the creation of the Ten Commandments back in the Old Testament in Exodus. So that's our best guess. So he's writing in the ground in the dirt, and they keep badgering him, and so he straightens up and he says to them, "Let any one of you who's without sin be the first to throw a stone at her." And he stoops down and begins writing on the ground again. At this, those who heard began to go away, one at a time, the older ones first, until only Jesus was left with the woman still standing there. Isn't that great? The older ones left first. There's two reasons why this could happen. All of a sudden, they saw Jesus' logic. Yeah, none of us are perfect, and so I'm going to slink away. So they either left because they were wise, or they left because they were old and had a lot of time to break all those commandments. You know, some of them are really internal stuff, like don't envy. Woo! That's the 10th. Don't lie. There's a lot of in there. There's a lot in there that is easily breakable. And so the older ones slink off, and then the young ones are like, oh, yeah, I guess. And they slink off, and Jesus is left alone with the woman. And he says, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" "No one, sir." "Then neither do I," Jesus declares. "Go now and leave your life of sin." Now, I'm not going to preach about the big idea of this passage. I want to preach about the mindset that Christ had. He had a courageous mindset, because his life, or his livelihood, his success, and maybe his life is on the line here. And her life is definitely on the line here. What would you do? There's a, I'm sure you've heard of Brené Brown. She teaches on vulnerability a lot. And in one of her talks on vulnerability, she has this aha moment. She talks about this aha moment when she realizes that courage and vulnerability go hand in hand, and you can't have courage without vulnerability. So she actually tells the moment where she discovered this. She was actually teaching to special forces at Fort Bragg, and some of the best military soldiers that we have. Lots of acts of courage. And so she defines courage as this: the willingness to show up and be seen when you can't control the outcome. Right? That's courage. The willingness to show up and be seen when you can't control the outcome. And she says that courage and vulnerability go hand in hand. You can't have one without the other. And vulnerability is basically the culmination of three items coming together. And those items are risk, uncertainty, and emotional exposure. All right? So if that's vulnerability, risk, uncertainty, emotional exposure, she says to the special forces that are gathered to hear her talk, she says, "Someone tell me an example. Someone give me an example that either you have done or you've seen someone else do where you were courageous, but those three things, vulnerability, didn't exist. There wasn't risk, uncertainty, or emotional exposure." And she said there was a silence for a while, and then someone said, "I've done three tours, and I've never seen an instance of courage where vulnerability doesn't exist. It just doesn't happen. In order to exercise courage, it seems as though you need those three ingredients: uncertainty, risk, and exposure, emotional exposure. And that emotion exposure is probably fear in some sort. And courageous people will tell you that the fear never leaves, they just learn to ignore it. And we look back at Jesus' situation, and there was all three. There was risk, huge risk for Jesus. They could have arrested him. They could have sidelined his effectiveness. They could have actually punished him in really serious ways, including death for blasphemy. There was risk. There was uncertainty. He didn't know how his response would be taken. And there was emotional exposure. But he did the courageous thing. And courage is the willingness to show up and be seen when you can't control the outcome. I want to say that in our everyday lives, so not jumping in the pond to save someone or a courageous act of war, I want to say in our everyday work week or everyday living week, we have 7 days in a week, I want to say that there are several opportunities for all of us during the week to experience a little bit of everyday courage, where we show up in a situation and we can't control the outcome and we have to decide what we're going to do. Maybe it's to speak up, or maybe it's to not go along, or maybe it's to say, I love you, or maybe it's to say, I'm sorry I did this, or it could be a million different things. It could be putting as easy as putting your arm around your shoulder of someone that just screwed up and who the boss just chewed out. There's uncertainty. There's a little bit of risk of reputation. People are watching, and there's emotional exposure. How's it going to look? Are you going to be embarrassed? Is it going to be awkward? And so I think there are like four major force fields that keep us from acts of courage. And my favorite one is called FOP. Anybody know the definition of FOP? Probably not. We don't use the definition anymore, but it's in Teddy Roosevelt's speech. He says FOP is something that keeps us from living into our ideals, living into our virtues. And FOP is an over-concern of appearances. I wish we still had that word. It's when you're concerned too much about how it looks, about how you will be perceived. Actually, I'm going to pick on the person. Sorry, I don't know who you are, so it's okay now. You're anonymous. Heather said, if I go to that marriage event, what will people think? Well, it takes courage. There's uncertainty, there's risk, there's emotional exposure, I guess. I mean, I would say it's very, very minimal. I've gone to a million of them and always benefit from them. But we live in a culture that we care so much about what other people think. A lot of Facebook and Instagram and now TikTok is based on portraying something so that people will think a certain way about us. FOP, an overconcern of what other people think, a fear of rejection or a fear of being looked poorly on, is a force field that keeps, it's a self-defense mechanism that keeps us from acting courageous. It keeps us from showing up when we can't control the results. Another thing is sort of knowledge and cynicism. And this is one that I could easily fall into. Why would I step in here? It's not going to help. If I step in here, it's just going to happen again. Or this could happen and this could happen. And so I'm really better off not stepping up. I'm really better off not saying anything. The cynic. What difference is it going to make? And we rationalize out of the act of courage. And we're unwilling to show up when we can't control the circumstances because of the explanation of cynicism or I know better than, I know how it's going to result. Another force field is, I would say, I'll lump two things into the same category, either a tough guy mentality or a checked out mentality. That's the third force field. A tough guy mentality is, I'm just not a vulnerable person. I'm not gonna get involved at this situation in work. I'm not gonna say this to my daughter. I'm just not that type of person. I don't say those things. I'm not vulnerable. The tough guy force field. Or there's the checked out force field. It's not my problem. We have all these little force fields that keep us from having the mind of Christ. And everyday courage is actually difficult. I want you to look at your next 7 days and see if you can identify. They're always small, and you usually don't realize they're a potential for everyday courage until they're gone. And you're like, oh, maybe I should have said something. Or maybe I should have not gone along and laughed. Or maybe I should have, maybe I should tell my boss to ease up a little bit, because I have the social capital and I'm the only one who could speak into this. Or maybe I should tell my son that I love him dearly and it doesn't really matter how his grades are, even though I secretly want him to get A's. Or whatever it is, everyday acts of courage are powerful. Christ shows us, he shows up when he can't control the outcome. There's risk, there's uncertainty, there's emotional exposure. We have opportunities all the time. And the easiest way to grow in giving in to these acts of courage, the easiest way to grow into everyday courageousness is by being rock solid sure of who you are. And this has been a theme throughout the last two series since January. If you have a strong identity, a strong biblical identity, you can handle any kind of courage. Because a biblical identity says this, that you are freaking awesome because you're made in God's image and God's likeness, and he doesn't make mistakes. You're strong, you're courageous, you have all kinds of skills and talents because of how God wired you. But you're also a jerk a lot of the times because you're human. You're awful because you're selfish and you have ego and self-defensiveness and fear. But God has forgiven you. And he's always trying to pull the best out of you. He's not finished yet. When you have these two heads and tails of the coin of the biblical identity, you can be rock solid. Because when you step into the arena and when you err and fall short the way Teddy said we would sometimes, it doesn't matter. Our identity's not at stake. What other people may think, the critics may think, doesn't matter. We have the creator of the universe backing us, and he's already vouching for us, regardless of the outcome. And if we think we're not, can I do this? Should I do this? Again, we have the creator of the universe saying, you are made to image me, do it. And I'll be with you regardless of the outcome. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to look for the moments of everyday courage. In your family, in your extended family, in your workplace, in your neighborhood, in your everyday life. We were just driving home from Rockport. We went to Rockport for just the day, and we were driving back, and there was an older gentleman, probably somewhere in his 80s, and he was slipping, and the sidewalk was a little icy, and he was a little unsteady, and I saw him out of the corner of my eyes, and I said, this guy needs some help. He's got to get to his door. And so I had already driven past him, so I found a safe place to turn around, and we turned around, and before I even got the car in park, my daughter jumps out and runs to this guy's side. By this time, he's actually fallen, and so now she's helping him up. I park the car, I come around, and we help him up, and we made light of it, and we're like, and we kind of helped him up the steps, and tried to scrape off some ice a little bit. I shouldn't say finally. It hasn't been plaguing me like for 20 years, but I stopped this time. I stopped this time, and it made all the difference. We have everyday courage moments. So look for them. Look for them in your place of work, in your house, in your neighborhood, in your circles of influence, as you're driving to and from Rockport or wherever else you're driving. And then ask for God for the grace to throw off your force field and step into one of them. Easy homework, right? Let me say a prayer. Heavenly Father, we would be lost without the courage of Christ that went all the way to show us your love and to connect us with you. God, give us the mind of Christ. Help us to see and respond in love, compassion, grace, and courage. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
I love that Teddy Roosevelt quote. It's a that section of his speech has been hanging in my office for many years now. It's inspirational and great thing to look at when you're having a bad day and you think the world's kind of against you. But as Mike was talking today, I could not help but think of such a great example that we all witnessed today of being the man in the arena, and that was Mason. Mason stepped up today out of nowhere, 8-year-old kid saying, "I want in. I want to be part of this." And that is the man in the arena right there. So congratulations, Mason. Good job. I hope you'll stand up and feel free to join us in this last song.
Open your eyes.
So go with these words from Joshua chapter 1, verse 7. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the laws my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. I think there's more.
No, she's shaking her head.
That is it. I thought there was another verse there.